This video, we'll see some of the basics of instruction sets. So before going to, we should know the language which we'll be using for the micro operations. Okay, so before that, we should know what is a register. So in a register, what will be the specification, how you will specify a register. So a register can be specified like this. Okay, which consists of 8 bits. We will consider it with an 8-bit register. And it will be represented with a capital R and a number. Because there are so many registers out there, in order to mention this is the register, we name it as R1, R2, R3, etc. Then, the positions can be mentioned like that. This is from lower to upper. So, you have to mention from 0, 1, 2, 3 and higher order bits. So always this will be the lower order bit and this will be the higher order bit. Now, another way of representing the register is like this. You can mention here 0 to 15. Like this, here you mention 0 to 7 and so on. And this is another way of representing. It is a 16-bit register. 0 to 7 as a lower order. And from 8 to 15, that is exactly 8-bit. This can be a represented a higher order bit. Okay. So now, to start with, we'll know a few registers. One is memory address register, which is called MAR, where the address of the memory locations will be placed. So if you are going to read something from the memory, then from which location that has to be read, that should be informed. So that data will be, that memory location will be placed in this MAR. When you are going to write also, to which place we have to write the data. So that memory location is given. So the memory address, location is nothing but address. So that will be placed in MAR. Program counter. Program counter is nothing but, say for example, if you take this as a memory. Okay, let us imagine memory. Now just, this may not be like a 0, 1, 2. Okay, all are in hex. Now I'm just, for easy understanding, I'm writing like that. The program counter is a register where initially it will be the starting address, memory location of a program. Okay, let us imagine we have written our program like this. Okay, now initially program counter will be this. So when it starts executing, then it will change to 1. Okay, so why 1? It will show the next location to be executed. So when this is, when this instruction from this is being processed and it will be taken, this 0 will be in MAR, current location. So MAR will consist of the current location to be executed, whereas program counter will point to the next location to be executed in sequence, right? So now after execution of this, the MAR will take the value from program counter, because that is for the one which is going to be executed. Now that this will be plus 4. That is, then it will point to the next location. Now it is pointing to 2. Now the MAR is pointing to this and the instruction from this will be taken. So this is how it points. So the memory address register will point to the current location as well as to which it is getting executed. Whereas a program counter will always point to the next instruction to be executed. So for example, it may be a loop. See here. You may write a for loop. Or in a program, there may be so many lines. So here first may be a variable declaration. Okay. Initially, our MAR will point to this. Because first, this all these informations first will be loaded into main memory. From there only, it will be one by one, the CPU will take the value and execute. So let us imagine this is stored in some memory location. Then, where is the next one? That it will search, and program counter will point to the next, whatever is given here. And when it is, when this complete finishing, now the PCP, this will get incremented, the program counter will get there and point to the next memory location, okay, where the next memory, the next instruction, immediate next instruction is there. So this is how the program is able to keep the sequence, correct sequence, right? So the program counter is used for pointing to the next memory location to be executed. Time being, you know that. We'll discuss about the program counter in detail later. Then instruction register. The data which is taken from this, okay, that will be placed in instruction register, where it will be decoded by the CPU and it will understand what it is. Say, for example, whether it is an addition, a fraction, or some logical checking, etc. Those will be understood by the CPU, and then whatever is said, that will be executed. So initially, the data from the memory unit, memory, will be placed in the instruction register. So program counter and memory address, these two will have location. They have the address. Okay. Whereas instruction register will have the data or the instruction. Then processor register. After decoding, whatever is there, say for example, it may need one register or two register or addition, then that will be taken care by the processor register. But normally we say it as a accumulator. Okay, we will see one by one. So we'll see the notations which are used. Why we are seeing all these things, we are going to write instruction set. For any representation, any coding representation, you need, you for any coordination which happens in the computer, we have to represent them in terms of some micro operations for the human understanding. Okay, so then only it can be done, because we have to execute the programming, that program has to be written. So how you will write program, how you will identify which register is doing what. So for we have any microprocessor manufacturer will give set, will give a set of instructions to be operated on the registers and to coordinate, how to coordinate within the microprocessor, they will give some instruction set. Using that only we'll do program. So that is what we are going to see now. So we'll see some of the notations used. So before going through the instruction set, the transfer of information from one register to another register can be represented like this. See here, R1, see the arrow marks. So the, which means the movement of data from R1 to R2. While moving, the value in R2 only get changes. R1 remains unchanged. Okay. So just the transfer of data from R1 to R2, that is data from R1 is copied in R2, but R1 remains unchanged. There is no change. If the transfer takes place under, this is fairly plain transfer. But if based on some condition, okay, then it can be represented like this. If P equal to 1, then do this. Where P is the control signal. What is the control signal? When the read signal is on, or when the write signal is on, or when some other signals are on, then only this has to be done. Means that can be mentioned like this. So a control function is a Boolean variable that has a 1 or a 0 value. The above statement, this statement can be represented like this also. You stop this, you can represent. Which means if P equal to 1, then this takes place. That's the meaning. So this can be represented in a pictorically. See here, R1, R2, it is transferred based on this control. Okay, when the control signal comes only, the data from R1 to R2 is transferred. Okay, and that also depending upon the clock signal. This, so why this, this you can see this representation. This is nothing but already I have told you, when you give like this, it is positive edge triggering, right? If there is a bubble here, it means it is a negative edge triggering, but this is a positive edge triggering. So now we'll see the timing diagram. Clock diagram, you will write like this in an uniform gap, okay, like this, rising and lowering. Now, when the load signal is high, at what time it is high? Here it is high, which means you can take this as a, during the rising edge only you have to consider. Okay, here if you see, this is low, and here also it is a rising edge, but since it is low, don't care. Okay, nothing will change. But here, during this rising edge, this also changes. Now, the effect takes place. So, the transfer takes place. So, R1 to R2, during the control signals high, right? And it remains there for some time. And here again, during the another rising edge, this is lowering. So till that, the transfer takes place. Okay. Now, some of the basic symbols for register transfer, how to represent them. Symbol representation are letters and numerals. So here you can represent them as MAR is memory address register, R2 is the second register 2, and so on. Then using parentheses. So parentheses, you can mention the part of the register, whether from data from 0 to 7 or 8 to 15, which gets transferred. So you can represent like that using this within bracket. Here you can say that L, instead of this also you can say as L, which means lower order bit gets transferred. Then arrow denotes the direction of the transfer. So here R1 to R2, if it is like this, but normally you will represent like this only. So data is transferred from this to this. Then comma, it separates two micro operations. You can consider these two are taking place at the same time, parallelly. Then only you will represent like this. So R1 to R2, and then R2 to R1. You can consider this as a swapping. Okay. Then memory read. Memory read, transfer of information from memory where to outside the environment. Okay, if something has to be read from the memory, that we call it as memory read. And if any information has to be returned into the memory, that we call as memory write. So that can be, we will see some more registers as data register, which can be represented as DR, address register AR, and M is to mention that it is an address of the memory. Now we'll see an example for a memory read here. M of AR means address, whatever is placed in the address register, you go to that address and read. So for example, now let us imagine this is a memory and we want to read this information. That means you have to keep that address. Say for example, this is an address 0. Now what you will do? You will read like this. If I am going to read this first. So address, this is address, that is what here we place. So read the data from the address mentioned here. So now this data is read and placed in the data register. Okay, the above statement causes transfer of information into DR, that is data register, from memory word M. This is the memory word M, selected by the address register R. So that where this data will be get, it will be get from the address register. Okay, so memory write. Now memory write can be written like this. See here, R1 plus R2 bar plus 1, that is complement. Okay, after complementing, you add 1. That is nothing but 2's complement. So add 2 complement and R1, which is nothing but the above statement content of R1 is added with 2's complement of R2, which is equal to R1 minus R2, which is nothing but our subtraction, isn't it? In subtraction, what we do? For the second element, we find the 2's complement and then add with the first data. So which is nothing but our subtraction of R1 minus R2, which is stored in register R3. So some of the symbolic designation, how you can represent it is here. R1 plus R2, these two are added and the data is placed in R3. Okay, then R1 minus R2, we do subtraction and place it in R3. Then find the complement and keep it in R2. So it is replacement. If you see, both are R2. Okay, so R2, find the complement of R2 and replace it in R2. Then here, find the 2's complement and place it in R2 itself. Then here the same, whatever we have seen here. This is what just now we have seen. Then R1 plus 1, increment. The counter, whatever is, say for example, before execution of this, if R1 is 5, then after the execution of the statement, it will be incremented and now it becomes 6. Same way, decrement. It will be decreased. If it is 5, it will be made as 4. So just now we have seen addition, some few symbolic notations. So which is responsible for this addition and subtraction? Already in the previous classes, that is when I take full add as full subtractor, we have seen. But anyway, this is only a slight brushing up of your memory. A binary adder, using four full adder, you can add 4 bits of information present in 2 registers. Okay, say for example, A registers and B registers. You can use a full adder, 4 full adders, because a full adder is used to add 2 bits of information plus a carry. So it is used for adding 3 bits of information. The carry is also added, and whatever is carry coming out, that will be given as an output, which will be given as an input for the next full adder, and so on. So a full adder, the digital circuit forms the arithmetic sum of 2 bits. I want to add 2 4-bit of information. So for example, I have A register and B register. It's what given here. So 1101 and 0011. So now A naught here, from here you have to consider A naught up to here A3. Same way B naught to B3. So A naught is 1, B naught is 1. Now what is this? A1, it is 0, and this is 1. What is this? A2. A2 is 1 and B2 is 0. And this 1 and 0. Now you will be adding these two. So when you add 1 plus 1, you have 0 and a carry is there. Initially, there is no carry, so it is 0. But anyway, that is also given. So here you can say 0. Now 1 plus 1, 0, and this is the carry bit. So now this carry bit is 1, and you have the, what is output sum? It is 0. Now 1 plus, here we have carry 1. 1 plus 0, it is 1. Again, plus add 1 plus 1, it is 1, 0. So now here, and this is a carry. So here carry, and here again we have a 0. Now when it is given, you can see from here itself, 1 plus 1, it is 1, 0. Here it is already 0. So here you have 0, and again here you have 1. Okay, now 1 plus 1, it is 1, 0, and again it is 1. So you have carry 1 and 2. So this is your output when you add these two numbers. So, and this is how you add. This is how you pass inputs, one from this and one from this. So it is added for, you can see it is used for adding 3 bits of information, A1, B1, and then this. So any 3 bits can be added with a full adder. And using this, you can parallelly add the 2 registers. Okay, so it binary adder, this are digital circuit that generated the arithmetic sum of 2 binary numbers of any length. So if here we have only 4 bits of information, 4-bit register. If I need 8-bit register, okay, 8-bit register, then I need 8 full adder. If I need 16-bit registers, then if I am going to use 16-bit, 2 16-bit registers are going to be added, then I need 16 full adders. Okay,